Awesome from Vampire Weekend. I'm one of the songwriters in the band and the producer. When me and Ezra were working on that song, we were very aware of the tradition of the pop song, which was based on this chord progression that you hear in Pachelbel's canon, and you hear it in a lot of other songs. And we were also aware, you know, that we wanted to, you know, put our own spin on it. So we experimented quite a bit with different ways of putting the chords together in that song. And you know, in some cases we got to a point where we had changed every major chord to a minor chord, and the song became extremely sad, almost difficult to listen to because it was so sad. And we eventually found a middle ground there.
If I may interject, Rostam, this is what your song would sound like with all minor chords. It's true, it's insufferable. And even the only major version would be ridiculous. Because to be 100% happy or 100% sad isn't realistic, and all great music tells a story that mixes up major chords with minor chords. Because that's how life is.
One thing that was an influence, I'd say, in some of the parts that I wrote for the song was Bach's two-part invention in F major. And if you listen to that piece, there's a moment that moment was an inspiration as like a texture where you have these two voices moving in that way, and that was something that I brought to the harpsichord parts for Step.
Johann Sebastian Bach, one of the first great musical geniuses, came from a musical dynasty, some of whom were in fact taught by the aforementioned Pachelbel, who happened to live in the same town as the Bachs. But Bach had to compose music for a congregation in a new kind of church, where he had to actually interest regular people and make music that they could hum along to. So in a way, Bach was the first entertainer.
One thing about Baroque music is that a lot of it was solo music, performed by just one musician. So something that Baroque composers did in order to make a piece exciting was that they would use these pedal tones where they would keep returning to the same note. Musicians call that a pedal. And the result is that you maintain momentum because, you know, you're always going back to the same note. So I actually have it on my laptop. This is a Bach cello suite where if you listen, it never gets boring because the cello is always moving. So that was something that stuck with me as an inspiration of how can we keep the excitement up. Such a strange relationship with classical music because I took one piano lesson when I was about 6 or 7 years old, and then by the time I was 18, I wanted to learn classical piano, which is actually very late. And another way, being sort of late to the game, it made me sort of hungry to catch up. I was studying classical music in school, and then at the same time I was working on recordings. In some ways, Vampire Weekend, which happened at the end of college, was sort of a marriage of those two. It didn't sound like music that had been made by bands. It sounded like something greater or something more or something just in a very basic way that was more interesting to us. And that was one of the things that drew us to classical music in those early days. All music is about connecting with tradition. It changed me forever when I had that realization, and it, it made me realize that in some ways I had a mission statement. I love all kinds of music that's inspired by classical music. I hear it in certain pop songs, like if you listen to Justin Timberlake, Cry Me a River, you know, there's deeply classical things going on there.
You were my sun, you were my earth, you didn't know all the ways I loved you, no, so you took a chance, made of a plan. But you didn't think that they would come crashing down. No, you don't have to say what you did.
I guess it's sort of the way that it uses the diminished chord, the way that there's different voices that are moving in a way that where their uniqueness isn't compromised, and just the way that the chords move, it's very classical.
What Rostam is talking about here is harmonic motion, the idea that we start at a kind of home base. That's the first chord of Cry Me a River, and then we go somewhere. Here's the diminished chord that Rostam was talking about. This is a chord that can never be considered stable. It has to go somewhere. And it goes up here. And then finally we get to a chord called the dominant. And this is the chord where you absolutely know what's coming next because we have to go back home.
Beethoven's Sixth Symphony, that's one of my favorite classical pieces of all time. It's something I just had a physical reaction. I mean, I didn't start listening to it until I was like 20. But, you know, I got through a lot of hangovers in college to Beethoven's Sixth.
Beethoven stands as the last great master of the classical period. But things were about to get taken up a notch in the century after him. This was the beginning of the Romantic era, which despite the sweet name, was very bombastic, bigger than anything had been heard before, and composers from all over Europe were writing music of unprecedented size. The Germans had Wagner. Norway had Edvard Grieg. The Russians had not only Mussorgsky, but Tchaikovsky. This is his famous 1812 overture. Here's Rostam again.
I mean, I think Tchaikovsky's 1812 overture, that was definitely an entry point for me. And I had a very physical reaction to it. Even as a kid, I was jumping around the house listening to it. The music I've loved, whether it's classical music or rock or R&B, it causes you to react physically to it. And that's something I feel about the 1812 Overture by Tchaikovsky.